I think we can start the second lecture. Okay, so this is just to recap the main equation that I will continue using in this lecture. So our problem is that of estimating the z and the marginals of that joint probability distribution of n variables of any kind. So at this moment, I'm not specifying which kind of variable xi are. And we derive these two equations, which we call belief propagation equation. Actually, we derive this equation on a tree, but then we realize that the same equation are those that you can derive if you impose the extremality of the beta free energy as a function of the beliefs. So the extremal point of this functional satisfy the BP equation. So if you run the BP equation on any graph where this is, let me say, the beta approximation to the free entropy of that graphical model, even with loops, and if you do find a fixed point of BP, then you are sure that that fixed point corresponds to beliefs that extremize this beta free energy. And the fact that this function is bounded as long as the psi a are strictly non-zero, you can easily check, it's just the average of logarithms. So as long as the argument of the logarithm is finite, it's not approaching zero, this is bounded. Since it's bounded, it has at least one extremum. So the identification between fixed point of BP and extremal point of the beta free energy also gives you the proof that BP has at least one fixed point. Okay? Then eventually we have to check whether we do converge on that fixed point or not. Okay? So this is what we were, and we also saw that given the fixed point of BP, so we are going to use BP as a, we are going to solve this equation in an iterative way. So we are going to put here a time t plus 1, here time t, here time t, and here time t. If you solve them in an iterative way, we call nu star and nu hat star the fixed point, so the large time limit of that iterative algorithm. If the algorithm converges, this is a fixed point of BP. And now what we are interested in is computing not only local quantities like magnetization energy, which only depends on few variables in a very close by. We are also interested in computing, for example, correlation between distant variables. I show you that on a tree or on a random graph, which is locally tree-like, for any pairs of variables, there is just one unique path connecting them, and so you can really solve the chain. But on a more generic graph, this is not true. And so what we want to do is to use the linear response. So we want to compute the, well, let me call chi ij, and I will do it for, in order to be concrete for the easing case, which is easier. No, actually, no. We can do it. We can do it in general, but okay. It will be simpler. So let's put. Suppose that the function is we put an external field on all the variable xi. So this in general is a function of xi, but let me stick to easing variables in order to make the notation simpler. So what you're interested in computing is the derivative of the average value of xi when you change the external field on site j. Okay? And so we want to compute this by a new message passing algorithm where that hopefully is still linear in n, so we want to solve this problem in linear time in n, okay? So in order to do this, maybe is well, I can do it in general, but since I want to introduce the specific belief propagation equation for the easing case that are simpler, maybe it's worth writing first the BPE equation for the easing case, and then we do the computation of this long correlation at distance point in the easing case, which is simpler. So let me, yes. Yeah. Look, there is an argument in the book Statistical Mechanics by Giorgio Parisi, which essentially says that if you look at the mean field approximation, if you have a small parameter that can bring the mean field approximation to the exact distribution, so suppose that you are very close to the upper critical dimension where the mean field approximation is correct, you can show that correlations are linear in epsilon, so they become different from the true value linear in epsilon, while response is quadratic in epsilon. This is an argument that holds when you are close to the upper critical dimension, and so in general, if you believe in this argument, then in general the response should be better. I will also make, after I derive the equation, a more practical argument that shows that actually you are summing over many paths, and so it's likely that you are really doing things better than computing correlation. So let me go to this particularly simpler case, because up to now we have derived BPE equation in full generality, but I think it's much easier to visualize this in a specific case. So let me consider models which do have pairwise interaction of easing variables. Yes. Yes. Yeah, because it is important that you increase the time once when you update all the messages. Otherwise, if I update the time also in the second equation, I will have new messages on even times and new het messages on even on odd times. For me, consider that you can think that you have a vector. No, because you don't want to update them in parallel. You really want to update in this way. Because if I consider a vector with all the new and the new het at time t plus 1, which is a function of all the new and new het at the previous time, this means that we are updating everything in parallel, which is not a good idea. It's much better to do things sequentially. Actually, I'm using this particular time update for concreteness, but in practice, you can imagine that any update rule where at the end of your step each message has been updated once is fine. Okay, so you can also decide to update first these messages, then this message, as long as in one step you update each message at least once, so you don't forget to update part of the messages, that is fine. And it's much better than do it in parallel. So compute all the new messages given the old ones. It's much better to do this sequentially, because in some sense you avoid some oscillation, some periodicity, which are non-physical, that are due to the parallel updating. Yes. Yeah, as you wish. So this just, let me say, the simplest updating rule, just to make evident that the time increases after one step. And then you can update the messages in the order you prefer. So I can even write, the time increases by one when all the messages has been updated once. And that would be perfectly fine. So easing pairwise models, essentially, are those whose Hamiltonian can be written in this way. The sum, now, these are a new edge set. Let me call it tilde, because it's not the factor edge set. Jij xi xj minus sum over i hi xi. And the measure that I would like to probe is 1 over z exponential of minus beta h of x. Okay? So these are pairwise models. So essentially, these are any graph, can be a regular lattice, it can be a tree, it can be a random graph, and I'm putting any pairwise interaction between any pairs of variables belonging to the graph and the local field term. So if you use these models, essentially the psi a of x dA is nothing but, you can write it as psi aj of xi and xj, and is equal to exponential of beta jij xi xj, just to make connection with the notation we use up now, and psi I of xi is just the exponential of beta hi xi. Okay? Now, also the cavity marginals, since these are distribution over two variables, can be perfectly represented by one number. Okay? So I make a change of variable in order to make explicit that the cavity marginal just depend on one number. And so I use the following change of variables. Let me write it here. The new message from I to edge ij, which was the previous new ia, now I write it proportional to, the proportionality factor don't matter as long as you don't want, so you will see even in the, this is a good exercise for you, since I ask you to compute explicitly this free energy, you can check that this free entropy doesn't change if you change the normalization to these cavity marginals. So essentially, if you take all marginals which are normalized to 2 instead of 1, all the normalization cancels. So this is just to say that I don't have to care very much about the constant in front. I can always add it at any moment if you ask me, really give me the correct cavity margin, I will put the right number. But when I run the algorithm, I don't have to care about the exact normalization, because at the end, even if I plug here some distribution which are not well normalized, the outcome is the same. You can really check that all this log of z, they are invariant under global renormalization of the cavity marginals. So I always put this proportionality factor, and this will be exponential of beta h from I to j xi. You see, this depends on the variable you start from, and the nu hat, which goes from factor ij to j, this is proportional to exponential of beta uij xj. This depends on the variable it points to, okay? So it's a marginal on the receiving variable. This is a marginal on the sending variable, okay? So once you do this change of variable, now we can take this expression and plug it into the BP equation. So let me start from this one, which is simple. You see, we wrote nu hat in exponential form. So the product of exponential is just the exponential of the sum of the exponents. And so since also this psi I is in exponential form, and also this nu is in exponential form, it's not surprising that the first of the two BP equations reads the fields, the cavity fields going from I to j is just the magnetic field you have on spin I plus all the incoming messages of type UK2i, sum over all the k which are neighbors of I but j, which is the direction where you send the message. Okay? So what you're doing in I, you are taking all the incoming messages U, you sum also the field HI, which is here, and then you send in the output towards J the sum of the incoming messages plus H. And if you do the same for the other equation, the other equation is a little bit more it requires a little bit more of work, so maybe I will write to you the expression. I will anyhow, it's not very difficult. I tell you the trick. Essentially, every time you have a binary variable x, exponential of ax can be always written as hyperbolic cosine of a times 1 plus x hyperbolic tangent of a. Okay? This is an identity. Just check it for x equal 1. For x equal 1, you solve it and you get exponential of a. Okay? So, there is a factor 2, because if I sum over a, no, it's correct. If I sum over x, I get exponential of a plus exponential of minus a, which is twice the hyperbolic cosine. Okay? So if you use this trick, essentially, you can rewrite the second equation, which is this one, by instead of taking this exponential form, use this form. This is a constant, so you can avoid. So you can write 1 plus is nu hat, so I have to take this. 1 plus x j hyperbolic tangent of beta j I j, which is I just rewrote. Beta u from I to j. So I rewrote this expression using this trick. And this should be equal proportional to the sum over xi, which is this sum here over the only variable that remains in the factor, which is xi. Now, the interaction term you rewrite in the same way, so it's 1 plus hyperbolic tangent of beta jij xi xj, because xi xj is again a variable which is binary, times the incoming messages, which is unique, is only this message here. So 1 plus hyperbolic tangent of beta h I j x I. Now doing the sum here is trivial, because essentially you have some constant term, which is 1. One term which don't depend on x I, which is this hyperbolic tangent of beta j times the hyperbolic tangent of beta h, because x I and x I cancel, and only and the other two depends linearly on xi, and so when you take the sum, they disappear. So the final result is that this is proportional to 1 plus hyperbolic tangent of beta jij, hyperbolic tangent of beta hij, times xj. If you compare this to this, you get the updating rule for the message, the cavity message u, that you can write more in a more compact way, introducing a function u hat of jij and hij, where the function u hat of j and h is just 1 over beta arc hyperbolic tangent of beta j hyperbolic tangent of beta h. Okay? So, this and the other one are the updating rule for, in the case of the easing variables. So, an exercise for you. Now, these are generic for any easing model, but just to practice a little bit, exercise, solve the model which is homogeneous. So, the simplest one. So, the equation will become equation for a scalar. But, so, solve the homogeneous easing model, where you can take, for example, J constant, if you want one, or as long as it is positive, it's fine, but set it to one. So, and also the fields constant. And take as a graph, because all this depends on the graph defined by the edge set E tilde, take as a graph a graph of fixed degree. I don't need to specify anything else, in the sense that you will see that this BP equation only cares locally how the graph is made. So as soon as I told you that the graph is locally perfectly homogeneous, so each node has degree D, so take a graph, this identify a graph of fixed degree equal to D. Okay? In particular, this is the case that applies to regular lattices, where D is usually twice the dimension. So if you study with D equal 4, it's like studying the two-dimensional regular square lattice. Okay? So do this and compute, for example, the magnetization, the energy, and also the critical temperature, if any. You can look for the critical temperature. So essentially, you have to look for the temperature where the equation that you are writing start admitting more than one solution, okay? As usual when you have a phase transition. And if you want, you can compare the number you get for the critical temperature, but also for the energy, but it requires a little bit more of work. Compare this number with what you get using, for example, naive mean field, or if you take the case D equal 4, which corresponds to the two-dimensional easing model, you can ask yourself what is the exact result in 2D. Okay? So you think that this is a mean field approximation to a 2D model, and so you know the exact value of the critical temperature. You find it everywhere. And you compute the critical temperature under the beta approximation, under naive mean field, and you compare, you see how better it is with respect to the naive mean field approximation. Okay, now that we have a simpler equation, because you see now the equations are much simpler than before, let me come back to the problem of computing correlation at a distance time. No, this I have to keep. I want to write this expression. Okay, so how can I compute this? First of all, the idea is that when I change a little bit the field in one point, all the messages propagating from that point will modify a little bit. And these messages modified reaches the point I, where I'm measuring the magnetization, and will change a little bit the magnetization. Okay? This give me, so the propagation of this perturbation, it will provide me the information about the response between site I and site J, also the correlation. So how can I do this? Well, first of all, you can write explicitly, given this simplify equation, the value of mean value of xi. The mean value of xi is rather simple. You can do the computation, but it's just the hyperbolic tangent of beta hi, so the field on I, plus all the incoming messages. So the sum over the neighbors of the messages u coming from j to I. And there is another beta factor here. Okay? So this expression explicit for the mean value of xi, where these are the fixed point messages. So you already run BP, you converge, and so you can measure the xi in I. Now you want to understand what happened to this mean value when you change the field in a different place. So this effect will arrive through a modification of the incoming messages. So the incoming messages will be modified because you modify the external field in a distant point. And so when you compute this chi ij, essentially what you have to take the derivative with respect to these incoming messages. So you first take the derivative of hyperbolic tangent, which is 1 minus hyperbolic tangent square. So this is 1 minus xi square, times the derivative of the argument. So this beta times the sum over all the neighbors of the derivative of u ji with respect, so let me suppose that I'm perturbing in the origin, okay? I put the perturbation in the origin. So this is the derivative with respect to the change of the field in the origin, okay? So how to compute this efficiently? Well, you can do the same derivative, but in the BP equation. So now I'm interested in understanding how much a cavity message changes when I change a field in a specific point. I can try to derive a linear equation, because I'm interested in small changes, a linear equation for this quantity directly from the BP equation. Okay? So this is what I would like to do now. Not in detail, but just to show you. So if you take, for example, this equation here, you realize that the derivative of the message going from I to J with respect to change of the field in the origin, you just have to take derivative. So this quantity will change, because this quantity also change. Everything is self-consistent. And so this is nothing but u hat prime. So the derivative with respect to the, say, the second argument. Actually, I could have written this in order not to make confusion in this way. So there is just one argument, and when we take derivative, there is no confusion. So, okay? So in this way, there is no confusion. And since you are doing linear expansion, you are going to compute this derivative on the fixed point. And then you have to take the, and here you have the derivative of hij to respect to h naught. Okay? And you do the same for the other equation, which is written here. But here you have to be careful, because sometimes it may happen that you take derivative of a message coming exactly from the origin. In that case, this is h naught. You have to take it into account, okay? And so you do the derivative of the other message from I to J with respect to H naught, and this will be a term which is a delta function if Hi is exactly H naught, so this is a delta I naught, plus the sum over all the incoming messages, so the sum over K, which belongs to the neighbors of I minus J, of the derivative. So this the sum, so you just have to take this derivative, and that's all. So you see we have a set of linear equation, because now these are linear equation, in all the derivative of the cavity message with respect to one external field. And so this is like a source term that in some sense pushes, so introduces the perturbation into the system, and then the perturbation propagates, and these are the equations for following the propagation of the linear perturbation. And this factor that you can compute explicitly, you will see, is of absolute value smaller than one, is like an attenuation factor. So you see what's happening. Essentially, given a lattice or any graph, let me draw a two-dimensional lattice, which is easier to draw on a blackboard. Essentially, you are perturbing in one point, and all the messages leaving this point will change a little bit according to this rule. So the message leaving from zero, it will get a constant term, plus everything which is coming from the other side, but at the beginning, say, almost nothing coming from the other side. But then these messages propagates, eventually they can even come back, and so they can give new contribution. So, and you see, if you're interested in computing the correlation between this point and this point, what you are actually doing in a recursive way is to sum over all the paths connecting this point, even very long path, because essentially, you are doing the And along all these paths, you are doing the product of this attenuation factor. So every time you pass through a coupling Jij, you get an attenuation. If you do the computation explicitly, you see that this attenuation factor essentially depends on the intensity of the coupling. So if the coupling is very strong, you propagate the perturbation without attenuation. If the coupling is weak, you propagate the perturbation with a strong attenuation. In this way, you have to solve this equation, so you have to think that at the fixed point, you will have a very strong value, because when you reach the fixed point, then you have to sum and get the response on each point. So you expect the response to be very strong, close to the point where you put the perturbation, and to decay. Okay? And so this algorithm is called susceptibility propagation. In our community, has been proposed for the first time by Marc Messier and Thierry Morat, if I remember correctly, but maybe it was already used in other fields, because belief propagation has been invented, reinvented in different fields of research many times. So, okay, so, yes. Yes, definitely. So, this is why I was drawing essentially only these four, because since this factor usually is smaller than one, much smaller than one. Well, it depends on J, but essentially, for example, in the easing case, if you take the derivative, you realize that this factor here, this U prime, is roughly hyperbolic tangent of beta Jij. Okay? So you see, it's definitely smaller than one, and if you are at not too low temperature, it's much smaller than one. So this means that the shortest paths are those that provides you the strongest contribution.
Right, so I guess the strength of the contribution of path K is the length of the path.
Yes.
At the same time, there are more possibilities for a long path, and
it's the
series.
On a regular lattice, not really. So on a regular lattice, I will see BP fails because of the loops, essentially. So because you are summing up the same contribution too many times, because you derive an equation assuming that there are no short loops, and then the loops there are, and so you get too many contributions. On random graph, we will see that indeed, in order to find the points, the critical points, we have to make a balance between the decay of the correlation and the fact that the number of neighbors is growing exponentially. The two are two different effects, and when they perfectly balance, you reach the critical point. Good observation. Okay, so let me notice one last point about this. So this, you see, essentially allows to compute also a correlation at distant points. So essentially you have an algorithm that, if it works, is providing you a very good approximation, and in linear time you compute many things. So it's very, very, very useful. But let me point out one more important connection between this computation of a physical susceptibility. If you want to compute, for example, the ferromagnetic susceptibility, let me write it here, because this is important. Suppose that you want to compute the ferromagnetic susceptibility. This is defined as 1 over n, the sum over all pairs in the system, pairs of sites in the system, of chi ij. Now, suppose that you have some kind of homogeneity, so like in the exercise I gave you, which is perfectly homogeneous, you can write this as the sum over I of chi I naught, because you just take as J just one single site, which is the origin. So you see, the ferromagnetic susceptibility essentially is related to the integral of the correlation function, or the integral of the response function, and if you have a model with random couplings, J and J are random, of random sign, usually this quantity becomes zero for a trivial reason. You are summing objects which have random signs. And so if you want to understand whether this object, apart from the sign which is random, keep being strong at the largest distance, you have to introduce the spin-glass susceptibility, which is nothing but the sum over the square of the responses, okay? And so as long as they remain different from zero, at least they decay very slowly, you don't care about the sign. And so if you are able to compute all these, and again, if you are in a homogeneous system, this is like the sum over I of chi I naught square. So if you are able to compute chi I naught, say, you can compute these, which are physical quantities. What is interesting is that at a critical point, this quantity diverge. Okay? And so you expect to be able to understand something about criticality of a physical model by computing this susceptibility propagation. Indeed, we will make a stronger connection, but for the moment, let me just notice that this equation are exactly the same equation that you would like to study if you want to do the following experiment. Suppose that someone gives you a model, gives you a fixed point of BP, but you want to understand whether the fixed point of BP that your friend provides you is stable. So what you can do? You can put a small perturbation and see whether the messages naturally comes back to the fixed point provided by your friend. If you write the equation for that perturbation are exactly this. So in some sense, we are making a connection between physics and computation. So understanding whether a fixed point is stable with respect to an algorithm, in particular the iterative solution of the BP equation, may provide some information about the physics, because if you find that the BP fixed point is unstable, it means that these perturbations propagate and grow too much. If they grow too much, maybe the physical susceptibility is diverging. So you see, there is a strong connection which was not obvious a priori, because BP propagation is an algorithm for solving self-consistency equation of a mean field approximation. But what we are finding is that the stability of the BP fixed point is related to the correlation, to the physical correlation which are present in the model that you are studying. And so having BP not converging to a fixed point, you don't have to think that it's just a numerical problem. Maybe it has a physical meaning, and so you have to be aware of that. Okay? Okay, before going to. So at this point, I think that is useful to do another important connection to what we are seeing in previous lecture, in particular in Florent's lecture, which are the TAP equation. We have made this derivation very general, then we focus on the easing case where we can write more easily the equations, but we still we are keeping the couplings generic. They are order one, okay? Can I simplify all this when the couplings are weak? And when do I expect the couplings to be weak? Well, if you work with dense models, which is what I will not do in the rest of the lecture, but just for this blackboard, let's use dense models. In dense models, essentially, so you have to think that you have an Hamiltonian, which is the sum over all pairs of j xi xj. So since the sum is over all pairs, you have to scale the j with n, otherwise there is not a good thermodynamic limit. In particular, if you take a ferromagnetic model, you have to take the j like that goes to zero like 1 over n, while if you take a spin glass model, what you care about are the variances of the j, and so this is like taking the j of a random sign and of intensity 1 over square root of n. So the variance of j is 1 over n. Yeah. I will make it more precise in a while. Yeah. Essentially, when BP doesn't converge, if you have on a graph with loops, it may be to the short loops. But if you are on a random graph, that is the best evidence we have that you are approaching a critical point. Yes. Okay, so you see in this case j is becoming very small, so it's reasonable to try to expand this equation for j very small. Okay, let me say immediately that for dense model I will never use BP, because as you learn, BP has a time complexity and also memory complexity, which is proportional to the number of edges in the model. So in dense model, the number of edges is quadratic in N, at least if you take a dense PSP model, is even a higher power of N. So it's definitely is not the best choice. But I just want to show you that the BP equation corresponds to TAP equation. So then you use TAP equation. It's just derivation you do once, and then you use the TAP equation. So what you want to do essentially is an expansion in the small j of the u hat. And so you see that u hat of j and h can be written as, well, essentially the hyperbolic tangent of beta j becomes beta j, and the arc hyperbolic tangent, again, since beta j is small, you take beta j out together with the argument. So you get j times hyperbolic tangent of beta h. So this j times hyperbolic tangent of beta h. Okay? And the other equation remains the same. So, but let me rewrite it here with time indices, because as Florent told you, it's important that once we understand that TAP equation has been derived from BP equation, and BP equation have some time indices that are telling you when at what time a given message should be evaluated. So let me rewrite now the BP equation expanded in small j with time indices. So we have j h from I to j at time t plus 1 is equal to the sum, hi plus the sum over k, which is neighbor of I minus j, of u k to I at times t. And each of these u k to I at times t is actually nothing but j I k hyperbolic tangent of beta h from k to I at time t. So actually you can take this expression and plug it here directly if you want, but this is just to make more evident the connection with BP. Okay, so now what you are interested in, so what's the idea? Essentially I want to compute the mean value mi of variable I, which is connected to everybody, okay? In particular, it's connected also to j, okay? And from j, you receive a message, which will be u from j to I at time t, for example, okay? It's receiving a message. But the message sent by j essentially depends on everything coming from the rest of the world, but also something coming from I itself, okay? And since this depends again on the state of I, we want to we are interested in writing a self-consistence equation in full magnetization, non-cavity magnetization. So our equation are in these cavity marginals, and we are interested in converting equation for the cavity marginal in equation for full magnetizations, okay? And so here is where we have to be a little bit careful, in the sense that the message sent by J takes into account all the incoming messages but this one, by definition of the cavity method. While we want to compute something which depends on MJ. MJ depends on all the messages, also this one included. However, this is small because it's of order J. So we can consider that the message sent by J and its total magnetization are very close by, and so we can expand. This is the idea, okay? So how can we do it? So let me write explicitly the expression for the magnetization in I at time, say, t plus 1. So the magnetization now is playing the same role of H. So when you receive the messages at time t, you compute the outgoing message at time t plus 1 or your local magnetization at time t plus 1, okay? So this will be the hyperbolic tangent of beta hi, which is nothing, this sum with all the neighbors, plus beta, the sum of all the neighbors of the incoming message from j to I at time t, okay? And using this expression here, I can rewrite this as hyperbolic tangent of beta hi plus beta sum over j. Actually, I can write j without specifying that whether they are all, because these are fully connected models, so it's the sum over all j's. J ij hyperbolic tangent of beta h from j to I at time t. I'll just make a substitution. Now, the main argument is that this quantity is very close, but not exactly, to the magnetization of j at time t. It's actually the magnetization of j at time t minus something, okay? And the something is what was coming from here, which has not been included in this cavity magnetization, while we want to include in the full magnetization. So if you want to do this properly, just write the full magnetization in J. The full magnetization in J at times t is just the hyperbolic tangent of everything which is coming, and we take all these incoming messages and we divide in two pieces. One is what we sent from J to I at time t, which is the sum of the local field and all the messages incoming but the one coming from I, plus exactly the one we ignore in the computation of H, which is the message coming from I. But this message is arriving at a previous time, okay? Because of this, okay? You see, so in the computation of the, this is the computation of the total field in J at time t, because you have to take all the incoming messages, and all the incoming messages, but one produces the outgoing message, and then we add this in order to have the... So you see that hyperbolic tangent of beta h is very close to the magnetization, and there is this small difference, so you just need to expand in this quantity, which is much smaller than this one. And what you get, if you do the expansion, is that the hyperbolic tangent of beta h j to I at time t, which is the quantity that we are interested in order to write the total magnetization in I, can be written as the magnetization in J at time t minus, you have to take the derivative of hyperbolic tangent, which is 1 minus hyperbolic tangent square, and since you are considering already a correcting term, in hyperbolic tangent square is just mj square. So this beta 1 minus mj at time t square, and then jij, so the value of u is just jij times, again, you should have here hyperbolic tangent of beta of the cavity field h coming from I, but since we are already in the correcting term, in this part I can substitute to hyperbolic tangent of beta h directly the magnetization of I. Okay, so here I should put hyperbolic tangent of beta h from I to j at times t minus 1, but it's practically m I at times t minus 1, okay? Because I am already in the correcting term, which is j is very small. So you see now we have an expression which depends only on full magnetization. This full magnetization, full magnetization, full magnetization. So we have removed away all the cavity magnetization. So we can take this expression, plug it here, and we have a self-consistency equation within full magnetizations, which is TAP equation. I write it here. So the TAP equation will be MI at times T plus 1 is equal to the hyperbolic tangent of beta HI plus beta, the sum over J, JIJ times MJ at times T minus this correcting term, which is beta square sum over J, JIJ square, because you have one JIJ here and one JIJ here, 1 minus MJ at times T square mi at times t minus 1, which is this one. Okay, so these are the TAP equation for the easing variables, pairwise easing variable. So this should convince, yes?
Is it h j to I on the second line?
Yeah, but this we substitute with mi. Because since we are already in the...
Is it not split, the I and j?
No, because this what is coming from here. So you see, is this, u is j times hyperbolic tangent of beta h. U from I to j, you keep the same indices. Okay, so the message u that j is receiving is essentially the coupling j times the message which has been sent.
Right.
So the message which is being sent is just multiplied by j, and you receive it like this.
Right.
And so this essentially the magnetization of the sending variable. So this should convince you that TAP equations are the beta approximation for dense models. So when we speak about TAP equation, it's nothing but a more convenient way of solving the BP equation. You see that is much more convenient because now we have n mean field parameters instead of having n square cavity magnetization. Okay? So it's definitely much more convenient if you work with dense models. Yeah. Yeah.
And then we see from the equation we must be careful about square.
Didn't matter, but what I'm using here is that when I compute this magnetization, I'm taking all the messages at a previous time. So the message can be updated as you wish, but you are not allowed to compute the magnetization in J as long as you don't update all the messages. And so in some sense, the magnetization is computed with the... sorry, you have to do it careful, but the idea is that, you see, there are outgoing messages from the nodes. And from this, you compute incoming messages to the nodes in the way you want, because the time index is the same. Now, only when you do this, you are allowed to compute the new magnetization. Since we are allowed to do it only when all the messages have been updated, you can think that now is time to update the clock. Okay? If you were doing things such that you update one U and immediately one magnetization, this is wrong. But if from all the H leaving from the nodes, you update all the U entering the nodes, then now the clock can be updated, and so you can do this proper time indices. All this holds, obviously, when there is some fixed point to converse to, because there are also many situations where, for example, if you try to solve the TAP equation for the SK model that has been already discussed, is the prototype in our community of the disordered models. Essentially, if you try to solve the TAP equation, which are the good equation, because we are in the dense case, you don't find any solution. You know that solutions are there, but essentially they are not attractive enough. It will take a full lesson to tell you why, but still, for example, this is something that we understood recently. If you, on the contrary, run BP, which is inefficient, I agree, it takes n squared time, so it's inefficient, it converges. So this just to tell you that this derivation is correct in the thermodynamic limit, but as long as n is, say, 100, the j's are 1/10. 1/10 is not so small, okay? So if you go to beta 3, beta times j is 0.3. It's not small at all, okay? So you have to be careful that this holds when n is very large, so when j is really very small. But for example, if you try to apply, to solve this equation on the SK model, you don't find any solution, and you have to resort to other tricks, which is... well, minimize the tap free energy instead of solving this equation. So always be careful. Iterative solutions are the best you can do when they converge. Yes?
If it is a numerically stable scheme, I suppose all...
No. In the sense, there are situations where fixed points do exist, but if you apply this iterative scheme, you leave the fixed point. Now the question is that fixed point something which has a physical meaning or not? So should I count it or not? In particular, since the fixed point of BP are related to the extremal point of beta free energy, when the beta free energy has many extremal points, has minima, has maxima, has saddle points, only part of this do correspond to physical states that you would like to count. So obviously if you initialize BP on a point which is unstable, maybe it's because that configuration corresponds to an unphysical state, metastable state. Okay, or a saddle point. It's very hard to visualize because the beta free energy has a convex part and a concave part. So I cannot say take the true minimum. Typically, the extremal point of beta it can be a saddle point. So it's not easy to visualize as when you plot f of m. F of m is easy, it's in one dimension. In that case, you have much more parameters and it's very hard to visualize. But in general, there are fixed point that solve the BP equation, but if you do iterative solution, you go away. No, when you are very close to the fixed point, it doesn't matter. But if you don't use the right time indices, you don't approach it. Because when you are far away, then the magnetizations are still changing quite a lot. And so having the right subtraction, because essentially here you are interested in this part effectively computes the cavity magnetization. But in order to effectively compute the cavity magnetization, you have to subtract from mj at times t the right quantity, the quantity that you really put in the sum. And the quantity that you really put in the sum was mi at times t minus 1. If you subtract mi at times t, that in the meanwhile change. And so from the sum of mj, you subtract a different term from the one that you really put into the sum when you compute it by BP. Okay, so this is why you have to be careful. So when these terms are still large, and especially so, this is crucial. Then obviously I agree with you. When you are approaching, all the magnetizations are changing by a tiny amount. So taking the old one or the new one doesn't make any change. At most, I never studied. It may change a little bit the power by which you converge to the fixed point. Because all these fixed points, you reach it by in a power law way or an exponential way. So that the slope or the rate by which you approach it, it can change if you use the wrong indices. But as long as you are very close, you don't break the stability of the fixed point. Yeah. You get this. Notice, you not always have this term. If you're in the Ferro case, where j is 1 over n, j square is 1 over n square. And so since you have a sum over n elements of 1 over n square, all this part here is 1 over n. So this is just to say that this derivation is very general, and it includes the naive mean field. What is the naive mean field? It's up to here. This is naive mean field, when it is correct. For example, in the Ferro case, because this term is 1 over n. And so you just have to keep this, because it's 1 over n, sum over n elements, and so this order 1. But if you go to the Spinglass case, you have to keep this, because the first term is the sum with random signs, and so this one, which is the sum of terms which are each one 1 over n, is of the same order of magnitude of this one. And so you have to keep both. So the equations are very general, but then every time, depending on the model, you can specialize. So the most general is BP. You run BP for any model, it works, but it takes much more time. So if you're in a dense case, these to be preferred. Okay, so now let me tell you one last technical aspect. Maybe I will leave you, since I prepared too many materials, I leave you one more exercise if you are interested. So at the beginning I told you that, maybe it's better here. I told you that for constraint satisfaction problems, usually you are interested in functions psi I, which can be written as 0, 1, depending whether the constraint is satisfied or not. And so, but all most of the things that I told you can be mathematically proved only if this quantity is different from zero. So it's always good to achieve the zero temporal limit by considering a finite temporal model and taking the zero temporal limit. So something that I will not have time to do, but you can try as an exercise, is to consider the BP equation in the zero temporal limit, and specifically for the case of constraint satisfaction problems, where you can write the psi I as exponential of minus beta, an energy term, Ea, where Ea is just something, say, which is 1 if the constraint is unsat, and zero otherwise. Essentially, the Hamiltonian, which is the sum over A of this term Ea, which depends on the variable centered in the constraints, is just summing the unsat clauses, the unsat constraints. Okay. So, if you take this expression and you try to compute the beta going to infinity limit, you will see that the BP equation simplifies, obviously, because you want to take the temperature away, you will have some maximum. And I just want to point out that one very useful algorithm that can be derived in this way, and so I propose you as an exercise to derive it, essentially you have to take this and plug into the BP equation, is what is called a warning propagation algorithm. Which essentially uses messages similar to, I use a notation similar to the one I developed in the easing case. So there are two messages. A message U from I to A, let me call U tilde, not to confuse it to the U of the easing model, but you see, plays essentially the same role. Xi, and which may take values 0, 1. Has the following meaning. Essentially, these are a message sent from a clause to a variable, from clause A, from constraint A to variable I, and is like clause A saying to I, you can or cannot, depending whether it's 0, 1, so 0 can, 1 cannot, take value xi according to variables, to what I receive from variables x dA minus I. So essentially these are messages, really clause A say to variable I, according to what the other variables are saying me, you can or cannot take value xi, okay? So these are a variable taking just two values, 0, 1, very simple, this for a generic alphabet. And you have another message, h tilde, going from I to A, xi. Again, this takes values in 0, 1. And is a message that variable I says to clause A, and he says, I can or cannot, depending whether the message is 0 or 1, take value xi according to clauses in my neighborhood but you. Okay? So you see, these are really messages. So clauses and variables are speaking, and they send this message. So you can try to prove that using these messages that you can derive directly by plugging into the BP equation this expression and sending beta to infinity, you will see that these two play essentially the same role of the message that you use in the async case. Again, you have to send beta to infinity. You can close the equation, and if this warning propagation message has a fixed point, from the fixed point you can compute a configuration that satisfies all the constraints. It's pretty easy to check. So if you're able to find a fixed point that satisfies the warning propagation equation that you have to write, is essentially the limit, the zero temporal limit of the BP equation that you have to write, you will see that these two messages, which are very explicit, can find us, if they can find a solution, so if you can find a fixed point of warning propagation, these messages provides you an answer to the constraint satisfaction problem. So essentially, all the variables and their clauses are sending messages which are coherent, and eventually they provide you an answer. So this, if you think, is very powerful, because you are solving a global optimization problems in terms of local messages. So I'm just chatting with my neighbor and say, I would like to take this color, and you, which color you would like to take? This one. And then this information propagates, and you solve a global problem, because what you are looking for is a global solution that satisfies all the constraints. And you are doing this just speaking with your friend, your neighbors, okay? So this is a perfect way of solving optimization problem, because it's perfectly parallelizable. You can solve this part on different system and then try to merge together the results.
Okay. I have a question about the transient impact.
Yeah.
So I understand that the that equations have a little problem to converge because they're marginal. But how, you said that the TP...
Actually, the equation, the TP equation in SK for M finite, they don't really have a solution. The only way you have to solve them is to minimize the sum over I of the derivative of the TAP free energy with respect to MI square. This is a potential. You minimize this object. If the minimum is in zero, you found a solution, because we are so. But here, all the people that look for the minima of this potential, they found that the minima are non-zero, and they go down, so the d min goes like 1 over n. So this means that if you really want to solve strictly those equations, we'll never be able to, because the fixed point actually are points where they are practically flat. This means that if you run iterative equation, you go away. You go away. There is no way. While if you run BP, you get a fixed point. Well, this is something we discovered last month. No one ever ran BP on this, but it seems that if you run it, you get, well, because it's like considering also high order terms. So there is a term 1 over n square, and you are considering more terms. I don't want to say that we are finding all the states, but at least we are finding that it converges more. So this is something unexpected. Say half the critical temperature. You have to use tricks. I cannot tell you all the tricks, but there are tricks. You can pin partially variables, but you converge and then you release the pin and you are still there. So you do find a fixed point with tricks. I agree.
Yeah, but then you can plug this in tap and be a fixed point of tap.
But if you do iterative, you go away. Because there is some...
You also go away. You are using tricks.
Yeah. Everything is very tricky. No, it's just to say that We usually present this as a well-known method, but if you then apply to difficult problems, we still have to learn a lot. So. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So it's tricky. Okay, so let me discuss maybe I will leave this for Yes. For the TAP there are, yes. For the BP equation, I don't know. I don't think so. But obviously the continuous version would be try to do a gradient descent on some free energy, which you can do, but because, for example, you can try to look for the minimum of the beta free energy. But since the beta free energy is not convex nor concave, so you don't know in which direction to go. So the best you can do is to, there are algorithms that find, they converge to an extremum for sure, because they split the beta free energy in a convex part, in a concave part, and they introduce some dual variables. So essentially, they first try to maximize the concave part, and then they minimize the convex part, keeping the first variable fixed, and you do this maximization in original variable and minimization in dual variables many times, and every time the two points they go in different direction. If at the fixed point they coincide, you are sure that you reach an extremum of the beta free energy. So this is the best you can do. You see, it's not easy to visualize. You are not doing a continuous descent in just one function. You have to use the two functions and dual variables, so it's a little bit more complicated. Okay, so since we are going a little bit late, let me start discussing the limits of BP, because at the end, in these lectures, I want to go beyond BP. I want to introduce you replica symmetry breaking and the more powerful method that we use in order to study replica symmetry breaking on sparse models. So, essentially, BP can fail for two main reasons. The first one is that the graph has too many loops. Have you seen the main assumption under which we have derived the BP equation is that the graph must be locally tree-like. This because we have used some equation which we derive on the tree, and we are assuming, essentially, you have to see you can visualize the assumption under which we have derived the BP equation. So the replica symmetric cavity equation has the following idea. You take any local neighborhood of your graphical model, so, and you consider, say, the tree. Okay, departing from this variable. There are some variables. Okay, so this is like a local neighborhood of your graphical model around a central variable. Okay, and what you are assuming when you write the cavity equation essentially is that the measure within this region, let me call this region R, what we are assuming is that the measure in this region, mu in R of XR, can be well approximated by a tree, and on the boundaries, you impose some cavity marginals coming from the outside. Okay? So here you have this, if this variable is variable J,
you will have here a new hat arriving on J from the clause which is outside on XJ. Okay? So you have all these cavity marginals arriving on the boundaries, and then you propagate inside all the information about the cavity marginals. And when you want to match this assumption on a sphere of radius R with a sphere of radius R minus 1, what you get is in between these two levels is that the messages arriving here and the messages entering the new smaller sphere, they satisfy the belief propagation equation, because essentially you propagate the information along a tree. Okay, so this is the assumption which underlies the derivation that we have made up to now. Essentially, you can visualize us saying that for any if you take a random vertex and you build the local neighborhood up to a distance r around it, the local measure on these internal variables is well approximated by a tree with all the boundary marginals provided by the fixed point of BP. Okay? Now, when this assumption is wrong, there are two cases. When, one, your graph has loops, so on loopy graphs, clearly the assumption that you can compute everything internally by a tree is wrong, okay? And second, when you have a long-range correlation, because the idea that the measure on the boundary variables is factorized may fail if there are long-range correlations, because even on a random graph where you don't expect to have short loops, you may have long loops. So these two variables may be connected by a long loop. In a random graph, these long loops are of order log n, but still are there. Okay, you are not really on a tree. On a tree, they are independent for sure. Here they are independent if there are no long-range correlations. So we have to check whether even on a random graph, at a certain point, a long-range correlation arises. If long-range correlation arises, the idea that the boundary is uncorrelated, is independent, is wrong, and so we have to invent a new ansatz for well describing the joint probability distribution of the variables. Okay? So what to do in the first case? Well, I will not discuss the first case, but just to let you know, if you have loopy graphs, you can go on with better approximation than Bethe, that comes under the name, so in the first case, of cluster variational method, originally invented by Kikuchi in 1950s, and more recently they have been extended to more general graph under the name of graphical model approximation. I haven't written it. It's a work by Yedidia on graphical model approximation. I don't remember exactly the name, but essentially the main difference is that in the Kikuchi expansion you take into account variables in regions and is specifically designed for homogeneous systems. So in particular, the mean field approximation consists in factorizing the joint probability distribution over single variables marginal, so you do the product over bi. Bethe is the product over bi and product over ba, then with some coefficients. And you can keep considering larger and larger regions. For example, if you are on a regular lattice, you expect the four variables entering a plaquette to be highly correlated. So you can consider one more region, which is the plaquette. And this means that you propose a better factorization also with the beliefs on a given plaquette. And you can go on. So essentially, Kikuchi proposed this on regular lattice, and then for generic graphical models, Yedida and co-works, they did some nice works on how to write this generalized belief propagation. Because obviously, from this, then you derive a generalized belief propagation. Okay. So if you are interested, if your field of research is regular lattices, for example, finite dimensional models where loops are abundant, you cannot avoid it, going in this direction produces much better approximation. For example, for spin glasses, if you use an approximation that considers also plaquettes, you can make this algorithm converge to non-trivial fixed point, while if you run BP, you always get only a trivial fixed point. So for spin glasses on finite dimensional lattice, BP is useless. Generalized belief propagation can be useful. So this is just to let you know what to do in loopy graphs. On this approximation, there is also a nice review by Pelizzola in Journal of Physics, say, in 2005. So if you want to enter that field, is very well done. Okay, so let me move now, from now on, only random graphs, sparse random graphs. So we don't have the problem number one, but we have to deal with the problem number two. So we have to understand from running our most powerful BP version and whether correlation arises and what to do in this case. Okay? Okay, so how do we measure correlation? And which correlation do we measure? Because when you have a model in your hands, you don't know which kind of correlation will be the most diverging, okay? So let me start with the simplest proposal, which is measuring connected correlation. So I'm interested in measuring connected correlation between two distant variables, and this you can write it. This is the definition of a connected correlation. And we already saw how to compute it numerically. So we have an algorithm that allows to compute this. And since we are on a random graph, we are sure that, well, with high probability, spin I and spin J will be connected by a unique path. Okay? So in practice, if you want to compute this correlation, what you have to do, you have to solve a 1D chain where this is I. Let me use just the graphical representation of pairwise models so it's faster. Otherwise, I always have to put factor graphs. J, but you have to think that this chain is embedded in a random graph. Okay? So, for example, say a random graph with degree constant equal to 4, you will have also 3 incoming messages from here and 2 incoming messages on each internal spin, internal variable, and 3 on the boundary one. Okay? So you see that you have to solve this 1D chain in order to compute a connected correlation function. And then you have to understand whether these correlations are strong enough in order to lead to long-range correlation, or they decay fast enough, and you can assume that the spin on the boundaries are mostly uncorrelated, so your tree-like approximation is fine. And as it was pointed out before, essentially the main problem is that on a 1D chain, you can do the computation by, for example, transfer matrix. You compute the largest eigenvalue of the transfer matrix, and easy to convince you that correlation always decay. Okay? In 1D chain, correlation always decay. So you can write the correlation at a distance r. This is the average value of xi, xj connected with I minus j equal to r. We can always write it in an exponential form because it's related to the largest eigenvalue of the transfer matrix. To the ratio of the two eigenvalues of the transfer matrix, because the largest is related to the free energy, and the ratio of the second to the first is the is the connected correlation. So this goes like exponential of minus r over xi, with xi is finite. So how can I have a long-range correlation in a system where if I compute the correlation, always decays exponentially? It's because the number of neighbors grows. And so when I compute the correlation between all my neighbors at a given distance, the number of my neighbors at a given distance is also a growing function, actually exponentially growing. Okay? So here I'm drawing a random regular graph. And so let me stick to the random regular case. So each node has exactly the same degree d. So you see that when you compute, for example, chi f, the ferromagnetic correlation, what you get is something like the sum over I and j of chi ij, or the correlation, since we are on a random graph with high probability, the correlation and the response are the same. You don't have multiple paths connecting I and j which have the same length. There will be one which is the shortest. And so this can be written as the sum over r, over all the distances, the correlation at distance r times the number of neighbors at distance r. And because you are doing the sum over all, this I0. I'm fixing the central spin. I'm doing the sum over all the other spins. So I can split the spins in terms of their distance from the origin. And so the number of spins at a distance r, actually they are d times d minus 1 r minus 1. Okay? So you see, even if the correlation decays exponentially, the number of neighbors grows exponentially. And so you can have a divergence of the susceptibility, of the physical susceptibility, even on a random graph. Something that you cannot have on a tree. And you may say, but a tree is like this. Yes, for the central spin. But the majority of the spins of the variable on a tree are on the leaves. And seen from the leaf, you don't have this picture. If you see a tree from a leaf, you have very few neighbors at the beginning, okay? So the number of neighbors, so you have much more neighbors at a higher distance where the correlation is very small. So on a tree, this sum never diverges. On a random graph, it can. And what you have to compare, essentially, you have to compare the decay rate of C, which is psi, so all this you can rewrite it as the sum over R, exponentially minus R over C, and this you can rewrite it, apart from boundary terms, that I can put it here, I don't care, this plus R times log D minus 1. Okay? And so you see that criticality is achieved when when log d minus 1 is equal to 1 over xi. So these are finite numbers. Essentially what it's saying is that on a random graph, correlation on each branch decay exponentially, but there are so many branches that eventually you can reach criticality at a finite value of the correlation length. Okay? Okay, since you will be solving the easy model under the beta the replica symmetric cavity method, all homogeneous, you can also compute this quantity, because essentially you have to compute this correlation function that exactly the same computation on a 1D chain, homogeneous chain. So you will see this very simple expression. So you can try to compute the expression for the critical point depending on the degree of the graph, and so you can compare the ferromagnetic case with the spin glass case. D is the degree. Sorry, I haven't told you explicitly. So these are D random regular graph. So each vertex. Let's use a consistent notation. The degree of each node is exactly D. It's exactly the same setting I gave you for the exercise of the ferromagnetic model.
So in this way, all the computations are extremely simple, and so you can do the computation, and you will see that here it enters the product of some hyperbolic tangent of beta j, and you can do the two cases, ferromagnetic case and spin glass case, and you will see that in one case chi f diverges at a given temperature. In the spin glass case, chi f doesn't diverge at all. You have to consider chi spin glass, which diverges at another temperature, and you can look how the two temperatures depends on the dimension, on the degree of the graph. Since now time is over, okay, we'll continue the discussion about which correlation arise on random graphs that leads you to physical phase transition tomorrow. Thank you.